The Rubaiyat of a Persian Kitten by Oliver Herford. Wake, for the golden cat has put to flight the mouse of darkness with his paw of light, which means, in plain and simple everyday, an oriental speech, the dawn is bright. They say the early bird the worm shall taste, then rise, O kitten, wherefore sleeping waste the fruits of virtue? Quick, the early bird will soon be on the flutter. Oh, make haste. The early bird has gone, and with him ta'en the early worm. Alas, alas, the moral's plain. Oh, senseless worm! Thus, thus we are repaid for early rising. I shall doze again. The mouse makes merry mid the larder shelves, the bird for dinner in the garden delves. I often wonder what the creatures eat, one half so toothsome as they are themselves. And of that inverted bowl of sky-blue delf that helplessly lies upon the pantry shelf, lift not your eyes to it for help, for it is quite as empty as you are yourself. The ball no question makes of eyes or nose, but right or left, as strikes the kitten goes. Yet why, although I toss it far afield, it still returneth, her goodness only knows. A secret presence that my likeness feigns, and yet quicksilver-like eludes my pains. In vain I look for him behind the glass, he is not there, and yet he still remains. What, out of airy nothing, to invoke a senseless something to resist the stroke of unpermitted paw upon the pain of everlasting penalties, if broke? I sometimes think the pussy willows grey are angel kittens who have lost their way, and every bulrush on the river bank a cat tail from some lovely cat astray. Sometimes I think perchance that Allah may, when he created cats, hath thrown away the tails he marred in making, and they grow to cat tail and to pussy willows grey. And lately, when I was not feeling fit, beweft alike of piety and wit, there came in angel shape and offered me a fragrant plant, and bid me taste of it. 'Twas that reviving herb, that spicy weed, the catnip, though 'tis good in time of need. Ah, feed upon it lightly, for who knows to what unlovely antics it may lead. Strange, is it not, that of the numbers who before me pass the door of darkness through, not one return through it again, although I've often waited for an hour or two. 'Tis but a tent where takes his one night's rest a rodent to the realms of death addressed, when cook arising looks for him, and then baits it and prepares it for another guest. They say the lion and the lizard keep the courts where Jamshid gloried and drank deep. The lion is my cousin. I don't know who Jamshid is, nor shall it break my sleep. Impotent glimpses of the game displayed upon the counter, temptingly arrayed, hither and thither moved or checked or weighed, and one by one back in the ice chest laid. What if the soul should fling the ice aside, and with me to some area's haven glide? Were't not a shame for it, in this cold prison, crippled to abide? Some for the glories of the soul, and some mew for the proper bowl of milk to come. Ah, take the fish, and let your credit go, and plead the rumble of an empty tum. One thing is certain, though this stolen bite should be my last, and wrath consume me quite, one taste of it within the area court is better than the table lost outright. Indeed, indeed, repentance oft before, I swore, but was I hungry when I swore? And then came Cook, with hose in hand, and drowned my glory in a sorry pour. What, without asking, hither harried whence, and without asking whither harried hence, oh, many a taste of that forbidden soul must down the memory of that insolence. Heaven, but the vision of a flowing bowl, and hell the sizzle of a frying soul, heard in the hungry darkness where myself, so rudely cast, most impotently roll. The vine has a tough fibre which about, while clings my being, let the canine flout, till his bass voice be pitched to such loud key, it shall unlock the door I mew without. Up from the basement of the seventh flat, I rose, and on the crown of fashion sat, and many a ball unravelled by the way, had not the master's angry ball of scat. Then to the well of wisdom I, and lo, with my own paw I wrought to make it flow, and this was all the harvest that I reaped. We came like a kittens, and like cats we go. Why be this ink, the fount of wit? Who dare blaspheme the glistening pen-drink as a snare? A blessing, should I spread it, should I not? And if a curse, why then upset it? There! A moment's halt, a momentary taste, a bitter, and amid the trickling waste, I wrought strange shapes from mar to mahi yet. I know not what I wrote, nor why they chased. Now I, beyond the pale, am safely past. Oh, but the long, long time their rage shall last, which, though they call to supper, I shall heed, as a stone cat should heed a pebble cast. And that perverted soul beneath the sky they call the dog, heed not his angry cry. Not all his threats can make me budge one bit, nor all his empty bluster terrify. There are no other than a moving show of whirling shadow shapes that come and go, meward through the moon, illumined darkness hurled at midnight by the lodgers of the row. Myself, when young, did eagerly frequent the backyard fence, and heard great argument about it and about, yet evermore came out with fewer fur than in I went. Ah me! If you and I could but conspire to grasp this sorry scheme of things entire, would we not shatter it to bits and then enfold it nearer to our heart's desire? Though two and two make four by rule of line, or they make 22 by logic fine, of all the figures one may fathom I shall never be floored by anything but 9. And fear not, lest existence shut the door on you and me to open it no more. The cream of life from out your bowl shall pour 9 times ere it lie broken on the floor. So if the fish you steal, the cream you drink, ends in what all begins and ends in, think, unless the stern recorder points to 9, though they shall drown you, still, you shall not sink.